Did you feel that rejection? not the worst song you've ever heard. The teachers of the Jewish law are trying to trap Jesus all the time. They're trying to always bring him questions and trap him. And the reason that they want to do that is because if he goes against Jewish law, then they can use it as an excuse to try to execute him. And the Bible clearly says, up until this time, they are trying to get rid of him. So, again, this time we pick up at Luke 10:25. Luke describes that an expert in the religious law comes to test Jesus. And he asks them this: "Teacher, what should I do to inherit eternal life?" So, and I don't know how this is a test, except that maybe this guy really wants to know, but it says he came to test him. So he's just trying to see what he'll say so that maybe he can get him in trouble. But in this case, Jesus says, "Well, what does the law of Moses tell you? How do you read it?" In other words, well, what does the law of Moses say? How would you sum that up? That's what Jesus says. So Jesus is asking another question, which Jesus often does, which is very cool. People call it the Socratic method, but really Jesus invented it first. So anyway, I don't know. Socrates didn't come before Jesus, but but the man answered, "You must love the Lord your God with all your heart and all your soul, all your strength and all your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself." And my chronological Bible says that he was quoting from Deuteronomy 5:5 and Leviticus 9:18. And so my chronological Bible says that those were where this guy, he knew the law, he knew the word of God, and so he says it. And so Jesus tells him, "Right. Do this and you will live." Now, here's the interesting part. The man wanted to justify his actions. That's what the Bible says. That's not my words. The Bible says the man wanted to justify his actions. So he asked Jesus, "Who is my neighbor?" Now, so he's saying this because the guy is thinking, well, I am very good to some people, maybe not to others. And so he said, "Who is my neighbor?" So he can say, he wants an excuse. I still don't have to be nice to these people. But then Jesus tells him the story of the Good Samaritan, which is an amazing narrative. And it takes place in Luke 10, starting with verse 30. It says that a Jewish man, this is important to know, he's a Jewish man, is traveling along the road. It's between Jericho and Jerusalem. Okay, now, if you recall in the Old Testament, Jericho had been condemned, but yet people were still building up there. So if it had been condemned, maybe there were a lot of kind of evil people that came out of there. But regardless, even though it was the Roman era of Pax Romana, all the Roman roads were fairly safe because a Roman guard could get in their chariots and get to you very quickly. So of all the places to travel, the safest place to travel during this time is in Rome, in the Empire of Rome. However, there's always a risk in traveling especially traveling alone, and it maybe it said Jerusalem to Jericho because it was telling you, maybe not a great place to go by yourself. I don't know. But this guy was traveling alone, and it says that he was set upon by bandits. And it says that they beat him. It says traveling along the road, he gets jumped by a pack of thieves. So these are just criminals who are, you know, all criminals are cowards or opportunists. So these are people that see this man, and they have take this opportunity to jump him. He's by himself. He must have had some goods with him. So they jump him and set upon him. And that is happening today. That is happening today. However, in Wyoming, a lot of us take guns with us everywhere. So we don't always worry about this, although it still could happen. And then if you want to go to Du Bois, they have tanks. So I don't think anyone should go to Du Bois if they're looking to be bandits. Just saying. There's some Marines up there I wouldn't want to run into. Anyway, this guy gets severely beaten. And the Bible says that he is left for dead, that he was stripped of his clothes, because clothes had value, special value then. People only had a few sets of clothes. Maybe this guy had some nice clothes, but he's stripped of his clothes, so he's naked, and the Bible says half dead beside the road. And here's the deal. This man is probably unconscious, because it never shows him calling out. So he's got to be unconscious. He's naked. He's half dead. If no one stops, he will die. That is what you get, this man, who looks maybe like a dead man. And maybe that entered into the picture. But first of all, in verse 31, it said a priest happened by. But when he observed the man, he crossed to the other side of the road. In other words, he did not even check to see if the man was alive. So as soon as he sees him, he moves to the other side of the road. Now, the priesthood, if you were a priest, a Jewish priest, if you touched a dead body, then you were unclean, and you had to go through all this religious washing to be clean again. So maybe the guy's thinking that he's dead, I can't get near him. However, he did not even check if he was dead. And you got to think, even if the man is considered unclean, would it be worth having to go through some cleansing to make sure a guy doesn't need help, that you should stop? And that's why I had to sing the song, How Much Is a Soul Worth? To you, to this man, even it's his own, another Jew, the man wasn't even worth having to go through washing, ceremonial washing, just in case he was dead. And if the guy wasn't dead, he wouldn't be considered unclean to help him out. Interesting. And I really believe that God had the Israelites have that rule of touching a dead body and being unclean so that they would wash after they touched things that could hurt them. If you think about it, the Jewish cleansing laws protected them from a lot of diseases. So in this case, he makes it into a legalistic thing, but nevertheless, he did not want to even look to see if the man was dead. He just moved around. The next guy was an assistant, a temple assistant. So he also works in the temple. And this guy, at least, comes along and he goes over to look at him. So it says in the Bible that he looked at him, looked over to see him. And then, so probably that guy figured out, okay, he's breathing. So that guy got close enough to probably think, okay, he's breathing. And he still walked across on the other side of the room. So there again. To either of these men, this man, this hurt man, was not worth their time. And granted, he probably looked really bad. He was really beaten. He was half dead, according to the Bible. And yet, they didn't even take the time to try to wake him. Like in first aid, they teach you to go, are you okay? You know, and they didn't even do that. They just walked away. So finally, as the story we know comes along, according to the Bible, a despised Samaritan. And if you've been following with us, we know that the Samaritans and the Jews hate each other. First, I thought it was just the Jews hating the Samaritans. But then we learned when Jesus went back to try to go through Samaria, an area he'd already been to through healing people, they didn't want him there because he was going to Jerusalem. So that shows me that it went both ways. The Jews and Samaritans hated each other. So a despised Samaritan which this man was a Jew. And they hated them because the Samaritans were half-breed Jews. So when the land was conquered and many of the people were either killed or taken away to either Babylon or Assyria, the people interbred with other religions. And there was not a problem that the Bible doesn't have a problem with people intermarrying. It doesn't want people to intermarry into people that practice paganism, which is what they did. So, but for whatever reason, there were very many people in the Samaritan area that really wanted to serve God, so they were trying in their own disorganized, lost way of this is the only way we know to do it. But in the meantime, they couldn't really come into Jerusalem because the Jerusalem people hated them. So they kind of had to invent their own way, which is sad. It's really sad. Because maybe the Jerusalem people should have said, yeah, come back to the temple. Come back to the old ways. But they didn't. They're like, don't come here. We don't want you. So then they invented their own place and their own thing. And they were really confused too. So anyway, this despised Samaritan is the only one who made a difference. And so what this story is telling us is that Jesus is teaching us not to judge people by their race or anything. This man was a human being. And so I find it really interesting that the people teaching that, critical race theory haven't really looked at the Bible, because the Bible clearly teaches us to love people of all races. So it's interesting to me that we're talking about that nobody ever learns to be kind to other races. That is not true. That's for 2,000 years, Jesus has been teaching us to love everyone of all races, of people that are different than we are. He has always been teaching that. This is an old story, 2,000 years old, and then some. And so, it's interesting that people naturally fear those who are different from them. But the words of Jesus tell us that this is wrong and this is ignorance, that we have to practice differently. And if you look at people like John Newton and William Wilberforce, it makes you wonder if maybe this isn't one of the parables that they looked at and said, man, this slavery thing is wrong. Jesus would never have allowed it. And so this is an amazing piece of literature that really shows that critical race theory didn't happen in the church, not in a Bible-believing church. So it's interesting. If there was critical race theory, I'd like to point out that Darwin was a racist, and he definitely believed in critical race theory, so maybe that's where it comes from, but it didn't come from Jesus, and it didn't come from the Bible. So it's good to know that. What we see about this man, who was of a different, despised race, that things that he did are just amazing, and I've listed them out. He goes over to the man and sees that he's badly hurt. He doctors his wounds with olive oil and wine, both which cost money in this time. So he cleans his wounds, doctors him up, transports the man on his own donkey. So whatever he was carrying, he moved it, set it aside, whatever, and put the man up there. Then he takes the man to an inn, a safe place. He pays for his stay. He continues to care for him. This is all in the scripture, which we know would cost money in an inn, caring for this man. And when he has to leave, when his schedule is pressing him to the point that he has to leave, so I don't know how many days he spent, it doesn't tell us. He leaves money and tells the man, the innkeeper, please take care of him. Any bill that you have, I will come back and pay. That is something. That is amazing. I love this. That is, wow, who would do this? And this is the words of Jesus. Some people say, if you think about it, I'm always asked these questions. Well, do you think the man was thankful? Do you think he woke up? I always think these things through. Do you think he woke up and was like, you're my best friend forever? Or did he wake up and go, oh my goodness, a Jew, help me. You don't know. You don't know. Or maybe they were best friends, but then they both went back to their lives and never talked to each other. You don't know. But you know why Jesus doesn't tell us? Because it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter what he did back. It doesn't matter what he got back. It mattered that he did it. And that's why Jesus only talks about that. It's so amazing. Then this expert asked Jesus, or Jesus asked the expert, who was the man's neighbor? And the expert says, according to verse 37, the one who showed him mercy. And Jesus tells the man, go and do the same. And my Chronicle Life Application Study Bible mentioned that the man did not even say the Samaritan, because he couldn't say it, because that's like a bad word. So he had to say, the man who showed him mercy. He still couldn't even say what he was. Interesting thing that a theologian pointed out. So what is the meaning of this thing, this parable, which is amazing? We must love everyone, even those who seem different, even those we don't like. That's harder. We can't, you know, the Bible says even an evil person loves the ones they love. I mean, loves the ones who are nice to them. But a Christian has to love everyone. Doesn't mean you take, as we've said, everyone home for dinner. It just means that you have to care for their eternity and show them love in that way. So it also shows that racism is not God's idea. That's Satan's idea. Satan's the one who makes us categorize people. That's what he does. And judge people because of things besides their character. We should practice discernment when we look at people's character. But when we judge them for something besides their character, that's wrong. That's not biblical. So the key is that the Samaritan is the only one involved in this story that thought of this man as a real person. And he is the only one in the story who stepped beyond cultural barriers to help a man who may not even like him in the end, who may not even speak to him again. Maybe appalled that the Samaritan put his hands on him. We don't know, but we don't have to know, because that's not the point, you know? And I know it happens here, because once Casey and I were coming back from somewhere on a Sunday, I think we were playing music or something, I don't know, but we were stopped in the middle of the road out here on the res by this really beautiful Native American woman, and she comes running out on the road for help. And we stopped, of course, and she said, please call 911, which I did. And I said, tell me what's going on. And she was with her boyfriend. He had been beat really badly. And there were two little kids with her that weren't hers, but they had fled some kind of situation. And they were stuck on the road, and these people were in the area. And so I was fearing, because they were mentioning that the people could come back. And so I told Casey to get in my car, put the little kids in there, because the young woman didn't want to go. She wanted to stay with her boyfriend, who was really beat up. And so I said, if anyone pulls up that shouldn't be here, you just take off with these little kids and get out of here, and we'll figure it out. Anyway, I call the cops. I tell them again, hey, we're in trouble here. These people could come back and hurt more people, and they need you to come now. Where are you? So they came, and then all of a sudden, we waited a long time, and all of a sudden they came, the sheriff and the police, and everyone comes, and all of a sudden, and they look at me, and I'm calling them, and they're like, what are you doing here? And I'm like, I'm the one who called you. It was weird. It was like, what are you doing here? And I was like, I'm the one who called you to come. These people have no phone. And then they took care of the situation. But I guess it was really interesting that what are you doing here? And I don't know if they were judging me like I was in this big party with these people, or why I was there. It was strange, but it made me think, gosh, that's an interesting statement. What does that mean? You know? And I said, I'm the one who called you. And it was weird. So anyway, I think about that we have a responsibility. You know, I think we need to pray about it. We can't do everything for everybody. When we have our own children, we have to consider their safety. That's why I told Casey to get in the car, put the kids in the car, and be ready to drive off. Because you have to consider the safety of your family, very important, and not to put your family at risk. But the Lord really put it on my heart that this lady needed help. She didn't ask for anything except for, please call 911. That tells me she's in real trouble, and she's legit, and she was. So the Jews, this, I want to also point out here that the Jews had very serious laws and protocols about hospitality. They're required by Mosaic law to help somebody who comes along and to help somebody in need if they need it. So these two guys that walked right by the half-dead man, they were breaking, as far as I can see, Jewish law. And I'll have to do some more search into it, but you were not allowed to, if somebody came to your house for food or needed to stay because of the way it was, you were required to help them in some way. So I would say that both of these men were breaking the Mosaic law, because the Mosaic law required hospitality, which leads us to the next important thing in Jesus' life. This is very important. In Luke 10:38, right after this event happened, or he's talking to these people, he then goes to see his friends Mary, Martha, and Lazarus. Now, later on, we get the idea. Right now, we don't know in the scriptures, but later on, we know these are his close friends. Like, these are his buddies. These are people that he confides and loves, these people. But maybe this is one of their first visits. I don't know. But they have asked Jesus to come into their house. They are showing hospitality, which was expected by Jewish law. They are asking Jesus in, and with that, that means you have to feed the people and take care of them. And so what happens is they ask him in, and Mary is sitting. The Bible says she's sitting at the feet of Jesus and just listening intently to him. She's just like sucking in every moment of Jesus. Now Martha, on the other hand, she's taking the hospitality thing to the highest level, and she's cooking for everyone and doing everything and doing all this stuff in the background. And you know, so for me, being somebody who's not that great of a cook, I don't really get caught in this piece, but I do work and try to help people, but I'm usually not the one at family events in the background cooking for everyone, okay? That's Matt, or other people, or Dell, or all my sisters-in-law, and who can cook better than I can, or my sister, who can cook much. Anyway, those people, but you know what? I have learned to really engage with people, so when we have a family event, I'm having fun, because I'm talking to the people, and I'm engaging with people, because that's what I love to do. So, but at the same time, I have also learned that I probably should get up and clean the dishes since I only made the salad, right? So I have learned that I can talk to people and then maybe I should go help clean up so that I can do my part, right? So I can do the thing that I can do. And so, but anyway, Mary is sitting and just absorbed in Jesus, and Martha is running around trying to feed everyone. She's so mad that she's, and it says in the Bible that she's distracted. So she comes to Jesus and said, "Jesus, Mary is just sitting here. Why don't you make her get up and help me?" And Jesus said, "She is doing what she's supposed to do." Because, you know, he knows I'm not with these people very long. And then I'm gone. And she is doing what she's doing. He's basically saying, "Martha, come down and sit with us." And he tells her, you know, come join us. You don't let go of this thing and come and be with me. Be with me, because I'm not going to be here very long. Things are happening so quickly around Jesus. And you know, what is the meaning of this piece? You know, there are times Jesus calls us to work. And then there are times that he calls us to sit and listen. And when it's time to sit in the presence of God, we should listen. We should sit and listen and be attentive to what Jesus is doing, and to really give him our time and attention. And I am guilty of being so busy that I, like, forget to enjoy the reason that I'm a Christian, to forget to enjoy Jesus and all of those things. And so that's a very, all both of these pieces are so important. We learn so much about hospitality, about loving your neighbor, but yet at the same time, making sure you love Jesus first. Love Jesus first, and then he'll show you how to love your neighbor. So in Luke 11, moving on at the same chronological piece, and I don't mean to hurry us through, but I'm just so excited to get to the resurrection of Jesus. I like pushing fast, but I don't want to leave some of this stuff out. But the next chronological piece is that ties it together is the disciples asked Jesus how to pray. How do we pray, Jesus? So this is so interesting. So he teaches them, and this is what he teaches them. He says, "Our Father who art in heaven," that's one translation, which really means, "Holy, amazing God, thank you for being the Lord of everything." okay? And then hallowed be your name means we acknowledge his holiness. Hallowed means holiness. We acknowledge his holiness, which is the same as Mary, to be present and in awe of the awesomeness of God. And then the next part is thy kingdom come, thy will be done. That's us saying, have your will in my life. And whatever you're doing on this earth, I want to be part of it. So I'm not asking for my will. I'm asking for whatever you're doing. Let me join that. And then the next part is really interesting. Give us this day our daily bread. You know, how many of us get worried about the future, how things are going to work out, you know? And you know what Jesus is telling us here? Let's just ask God to take care of us one day at a time and just really trust him for it. You know, we're not going to have things all figured out. I don't have things all figured out. But we have to take it one day at a time and trust him every day. And there's a lot of weird things happening around our country right now, and it's scary. It's frightening. And yet, Jesus is clearly telling us, trust me one day at a time. Trust me one day at a time. And so then there's a really important piece here that ties back to everything. Forgive us our sins or trespasses or debtors, depending on your translation. It all means forgive us our sins, those things we've done wrong, as we forgive those who sin against us. In other words, we have to forgive because Jesus forgives us. We have to forgive. We have to love those, the unlovely. We have to love the people we're afraid of just because Jesus loved us and forgave us. So, and you know what? And then it says, the last thing, he says, lead us not into temptation, which simply means, help me to be obedient to follow you every day. Every day. Help me to be obedient. Because temptations are out there. He's just acknowledging it. So he's telling us, pray that God will help us to be faithful every day. Now, sometimes when I can't even pray, when I just can't even think straight, I just pray the Lord's Prayer like over and over and over. Or when I'm frightened or when I'm facing a fear, I would just sometimes just pray this over and over and over. These are powerful things that Jesus told us. And do you realize that when you pray this prayer, you're basically, I mean, you'll be saved if you honestly pray this prayer. If you honestly pray this prayer, you are entering into a relationship with Jesus Christ. That's amazing. So if you just audibly, meaningfully say this prayer, you're going to walk into a relationship with Jesus. I think that's awesome. And so I'm so glad that I learned this prayer as a child so that when bad things come, I can just say, you know, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us, lead us not to temptation. And then it goes on to say, we know the way I learned, but deliver us from evil, not as the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Some of those were added in other translations, but you can just say that and just come into face to face with God, but you can't just say it. You have to mean it, which is why I wanted to point out the meaning. And so you're basically saying, and then we're tying it all together here. We're basically saying, God, I embrace your awesomeness, right? I embrace your awesomeness. I submit to your will on earth, to doing your will on earth. Help me to follow you and trust you every day. Forgive my sins. Help me to forgive those people who hurt me. And help me to follow you faithfully. That's it. That's basically all. That's what Jesus tells us to pray. So if Jesus tells us, then that's what we know we can do. So to sum up the pieces that from this chronological piece in Jesus' life, as he's moving to the cross, as he's moving to the place where he's going to lay down his life for us, these are the things that he's teaching us here. Number one, love the Lord your God with all your heart and soul and strength and mind, like the Old Testament, and also love your neighbor as yourself. And loving your neighbor means forgiving people, loving people, loving people that are different than we are and people that maybe we're going to have to forgive. And that we can't expect anything back. It might come back, you know, it might come back, but even if they don't come back, we did the right thing. So treat every person as a human being. Well, what if they're a criminal? Well, they still have to pay for their crimes, but we can speak to them as if they're a human being. Calling a person accountable for their crimes is still treating them as a human being. That's calling them into accountability, which you should do if you're a good person. Call people into accountability. So, but treat every person as somebody that God loves, because he does love them, regardless of how lost they are. Racism is never God's idea. So how Christians seem to get blamed by everything in this country, I don't know where that came from. Look at Darwin. Okay, I digress. Moving on. And when you pray, acknowledge the amazingness of God. Really, you know, really think about how awesome he really is. Really focus on how awesome he really is. Even when things are wrong, even when things are bad. And, you know, I had a horse die that unexpectedly this week, and it just struck me to the heart. That was really hard. And I was thinking, well, why did this have to happen, you know? And I don't know why. I don't know. But I embrace the awesomeness of God, that he knows and he'll get us through it, right? This world is broken. It is broken. But one thing that's not broken is God. He's not broken. And so we can lean on him, even in our brokenness, even in the things that are messed up, we can lean on him and he will hear our prayers. And he will hear us. And he showed us how to pray. And so we can pray just like that. And then we ask God to help us trust and obey. And with that, I just want to close with the Lord's Prayer. And if you want to say it with me, that would be great. I hope I don't forget it since I'm on camera. But anyway, our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, debtors, or sins, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Step out of you.